Welcome to the Spy Collection. I'm Anastasios and this episode is about a ComSec system from the Swiss company Crypto AG, also known as Hagelin-Cryptos from its founder Boris Hagelin. This is the Hagelin-Cryptos 422201 fax encryptor. Only a few hundreds of those were ever built and apparently it's not a lightweight device. This one weighs roughly 5 kilograms, that is around 11 pounds. The model of this device is stamped in the back of it, and you can clearly see it here. This device was sold to various governments from 1994 until 2002, when it was replaced by the newer model. The newer model was the 4221. Its formal name was HC-4220 Facsimile Encryption Device. Facsimile is known to most people by its shortened version, which is fax. Fax was a very popular communications method in the 90s, but it was never designed with security in mind. The fax signals are analog and transmitted over the telephone network. This means that if intercepted, they can be trivially decoded. For government agencies and the military, this was a concern, and companies like Crypto AG were offering this solution in the form of an external fax encryptor. The Crypto Museum was able to find the brochure of this rare device, so I reconstructed it and I'll be going back and forth from the slides to the device to demonstrate this unique piece of modern secure communications history and espionage, as we'll see later on. This is the reconstructed slide deck that Crypto Museum found. Its title is the HC-4220 Facsimile Encryption, Secure Facsimile Communication, presented by Crypto AG. And continuing, we have the Armed Forces typical topology according to Crypto AG at this point. What this diagram shows us is that typically the command headquarters have some communication devices, fax devices, for the context of this presentation. And through the telephone network, they are communicating to the local headquarters and divisions when they have to send some fax message. Then, the local headquarters and divisions, using the telephone network, PSTN, they are sending those faxes to platoons or regiments. And this is a typical armed forces topology according to this presentation of Crypto AG. If we move to the next slide, we can see the threats to fax communications. And this is a typical example like the one I mentioned earlier, that the fax communication goes over the telephone network completely unencrypted, just encoded in a specific code which is publicly available. This means that if anyone taps into these communication lines, they can eavesdrop to the entire communication and reconstruct all of the fax messages that are being transmitted. In the slide that follows, we see that this device, the 4220, was backwards compatible with earlier models like the 4400, the 4300, and the 440. And all of them operate through the PSTN network, the telephone network, or as it's known, public switch telephone network. This means that you didn't have to upgrade to this device, the latest at this point, the 4220, but it could be integrated to existing devices of different series. And finally, we go into the device itself, the phone line facsimile encryption unit. What we read here is that it had a telephone line interface, A and B line, which means it sits between the telephone line communication. It has an input and output line between any devices that will be sending fax. It is compatible with any Group 3 fax unit, and for those not familiar, Group 3, it's a publicly known digital format for fax communication, as well as PC fax boards and fax servers, which means it could also be integrated with computer systems that are designed to send fax messages. It had no restrictions on standard facilities and error correction mode, automatic adaption to protocol and speed, and with a specified bandwidth, PTT approved, and simple installation and operation that I'm going to demonstrate that later. Now that the general characteristics and purpose of this device are clear, the presentation goes into the security management. It is telling us that it's a tamper-proof security module, and we will see that later on. Also that the key or parameter entries can be configured by multiple different means. For example, the keyboard that you see in front of the device, you can better see it here in this video, by a chip card that I don't have it, but this is where you put that card with the codes so that you can configure the device, or by downline loading through the KHC, and this is the key handling center. It is telling us that it can store up 256 communication keys in active, spare, and expired keyset. And to select which one to use, it is having an automatic key selection, and we can see it says SCA, which stands for Shared Key Authentication. It is compatible with all Crypto AG facsimile encryption products, that was established also earlier, and the Key Handling Center, or KHC-4000, can provide security management support. Going into the details of the device, we have the phone line interface. As you can see in this very simple diagram, on one side it is the phone line, the PSTN line, and on the other side is the fax device that doesn't have to be any sort of special device. It could be any standard fax device, since the HC-4220 acts as the encryption and decryption layer. Everything that comes from the fax or to the fax from the PSTN line is getting demodulated or modulated with the modem devices that we see over there, and then encrypted or decrypted and sent to the device or sent to the phone network. Following that, going from the rear side of the device to the front, we have the cipher unit with a security module and the power supply. The reason why those are put together in this layer is because in the actual device they are sitting on top of each other. Actually, the power supply is accessible without having to open the device. You just have to open up the case as you see over here, and that reveals the power supply of the device, probably for easy maintenance and replacement. On the other hand, the security module is deep inside the device, so you have to disassemble it, and in there you cannot really access it since it is put in this tamper-proof case. This means that if you try to open it by any means, it's going to destroy the security module, it's going to self-destruct, so it will not longer be operable. And this is a key part, since those devices never revealed how their encryption works. And we will come back to this later on in this video. The last part of the device is the control unit. It's the part that has the keyboard and the small LCD screen that you see in front of the device. You can see in this diagram that it is connected with a gray line. This is because this control unit is detachable. The whole point of this one is that the communications engineer could configure the device either through the keyboard or through the chip card, or even the KHC, and then remove this control unit completely, leaving only the core of the device next to the fax devices. Anytime there was a need for a maintenance, they could either use the auxiliary port that you see over here, or reconnect this control unit. However, if you wanted to keep this unit permanently installed, there are two screws that you see on each side, and by tightening those, it ensures that you cannot remove it without first untightening them. Finally, at the front of the control unit, there is an additional auxiliary port that you see here. And in case there is any issue with the control unit and you don't want to remove it, you can just plug in a different control unit in this auxiliary port and do your maintenance in this way. This was all of the basic components that make the HC-4220 a fax encryptor. Going into more depth in those, we have the security architecture. The first layer is the phone line interface. technically, this is just a couple of modems, that is modulators, demodulators for the analog signals from the telephone network. That their only purpose is simply to take those analog signals and make them understandable to the next layer of the device. The next layer is what is referred here as the SQ4000 or cipher unit 4000. That is the cipher unit, the module that does the encryption. And we can see that the actual module is the security module 1500 that has a processor, a CPU, the program that is loaded through the different means that I mentioned earlier, then a RAM, a random memory, a temporary memory, a permanent memory, which is the EEPROM, and a random generator that helps to initiate the seeds used for different encryption methods. Finally, we have the CCT1000, which is the control unit. And here you have the keyboard, the display, the auxiliary port, the card reader, and of course the relevant hardware to support it, like a processor, the program that is being installed in the system, and its memory, and so on. And those three systems operate as modules, which means if there is an issue in any of them, there is no need to replace the whole device. They could be isolated and replace only the defective module. Then we have a high-level overview of the encryption concept, and I'm going to go through it quickly, since it won't be that interesting to most people. The device comes with a basic configuration. The customer can set some additional settings like the key encryption key, the key transport key, and so on, through the keyboard, the chip card, or through the KHC. All of those are being passed to the decryption algorithm, and that results in the output for the key distribution, which means the cipher key, the CK, that is going to be sent to all of the different devices so that they can communicate securely between them. You can see the output of this one here, that it comes from both layers, and we have the initialization vector, cipher key, and so on. And this is what constructs the encryption algorithm. This is the part that the secret part of the encryption process. And of course, the communication, how it happens, is that this device sits between any fax system and the PSTN line. So plain text data for fax are coming through that line. They are passing through the device. They go through this encryption process, and the output of the device is the cipher fax data. Of course, the opposite is also happening. The ciphered fax data enter this device through the phone line. They are getting decrypted and then passed to the fax system in plain fax data format. The last part is the key management. And there are a couple of different ways to do that. We know that in order to use this device, you have to configure the cipher keys and the device setup to be identical in all of them. This could happen through the KHC4000, the Key Handling Center, which is simply a computer software. How this was done was, first of all, you could use this device to program these chip cards, the KDC130. You could program them so that when installed, they can be used for the device setup, the key distribution, and key assignment. This means a human being had to take these cards, go to the different devices, put the card in, and load the configuration. This is what we see on the right side of this slide. On the left side is another method, which is using the computer software, print out a special page, then take this printout, send it to the different areas where you have those devices, and these people are going to initialize the configuration process and reconfigure it with the provided information. Both of those methods are considered offline, since a human being has to take this output and manually go and configure the devices. Whether this is a printout or a chip card, there is some human interaction that has to happen in an offline mode without going through any connected systems. The other means for key management is the online mode. In this case, the Key Handling Center 4010, it is using network connectivity, in this case, a modem to connect to the phone network. In this case, what happens is that the KHC4010 sends through the network fax messages to the target fax machines. And Once those fax data pass through the fax encryptors, they are going to initiate the process of loading the keys, the parameters, execute commands, update the shared key authentication table, and so on. This is the online method, since it doesn't require any sort of offline activity. And the last slide of this presentation gives us an overview of the key handling sender, the KHC4010, and the components it consists of, which is the toolbox, a device used to generate and encrypt the keys, to write, read, and copy the chip card, a computer with a removable hard disk which is running the key management program, with a protected database, the fax slash modem device in order to communicate through the PSTN network, and the printer to print out any reports, profile information, etc. And that was the entire presentation. In the beginning of the video, at some point I mentioned that this device also has to do with espionage. Many governments were using those devices, but what we know today is that from June 1970 and until 2018, Crypto AG was clandestinely acquired and operated by the United States CIA and the German BND intelligence agencies, using Motorola and Siemens respectively as their front companies. The vast majority of Crypto AG employees didn't even know that behind Motorola and Siemens owners and engineering teams was the CIA and the BND, who were intentionally weakening the security of those systems so that they could intercept and decrypt classified communications of foreign governments. Of course, from 1970 to 2018, there were a lot of changes in this structure and operating models. However, it is an oversimplified version of the later mode of operation. Motorola and Siemens owned 50% each of Crypto AG, and both of them were collaborating with the CIA and BND respectively. What the CIA did next is create a front company called Intercom Associates, and this company became a partner of Motorola. Crypto AG a lot of times were outsourcing engineering projects to Motorola as one of their parent companies. And what Motorola did for this engineering support is contract these Intercom Associates to provide engineering support for specific projects in Crypto AG. What we didn't know until recently was that the Intercom Associates was actually the NSA. So anytime a project was outsourced to the Intercom Associates from Crypto AG, it was actually being developed by the NSA. And in some cases, they intentionally weakened the ciphers so that they can intercept them and decrypt them with backdoors they have pre-installed in those systems. However, to do that, there also had to be some sort of influence on what devices had to be outsourced to the different partners, in this case, the Intercom Associates. And this is what BND and Siemens were doing. Siemens had created a council called Beirat, and this group was providing external advisory to the board of Hagelin-Cryptos Crypto AG, which means on that side it was influencing the managerial decisions, and on the other side Motorola was providing backdoor devices for specific customers of Crypto AG. It is not known if this specific device was modified by the American and German intelligence agencies. Of course, it was built during the time that they were owning the company, but as you saw also when I opened the device, analyzing the security module is very hard because it is built in this tamper-proof way. However, even if it was modified, it shouldn't be surprising, because as we say in the spy collection, nothing is as it seems.